Campus Sport with word on the upcoming Summer University Games in South Korea. We meet Alexander the Archer as we look at sport within the precincts of Oxford. Plus, the Sport Accord meeting in Sochi and the Universiade champion who became a government minister. Some 12,000 athletes from 170 countries will be in Gwangju in South Korea for the 2015 Summer Universiade, the World University Games. It all begins on July the 3rd, so with only weeks to go, the recent heads of delegation meeting was an opportunity to assess the preparations.
It's an advanced trip for all the heads of delegation, and they have the opportunity to visit the venues that we will host the games, to visit the village, and to have all information regarding the services that will be provided to the teams during the games.
110 delegates from 51 countries were there, including the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, North Korea. They came to look at issues like transport and accommodation, important issues for their athletes and coaches.
We always want to know exactly how everything is going to work on the transportation side, how it's going to work on the accreditation side. We've been through this many times, and you can tell that the organizing committee has also been paying attention to some other games, so it looks like everything is going to be smooth.
The inspection began with a baseball stadium. Baseball, the most popular sport in South Korea, and the Gwangju Tigers are one of their most successful teams. Their stadium will host the Universiade tournament. Among the delegates on the tour, Elizabeth Brett from Australia.
It gives us an opportunity to understand all the processes that are going to be involved in the games, and we can then go back to each of our sports managers and provide them with critical information on arrival, departures and the athlete villages. Plus we also get to see all of the venues, which we think is great information to be able to provide to our athletes as well.
Gwangju has followed the eco-friendly rules laid down by FISU. 70% of the facilities already existed and have been renovated. Out of a total of 69 competition and training venues, only three have been built from scratch. The Nambu University Aquatic Center is one of them. Another new building is the multi-purpose gymnasium, which the artistic and rhythmic gymnastics competitions will be held. The heads of delegations seem to like what they saw. Here's Wang Gang from China. I can only say that the organizing committee has put a lot of effort into the preparations here. All the venues we've seen so far are well advanced and of a high standard. We believe that with this kind of top-level sports venue, the organization of this event will take place successfully. Gwangju is the fourth city in South Korea to host a Universiade, but this time limiting the costs has been a priority, and therein lies a difficulty. Because as far as FISU is concerned, at the core of the games are the athletes. And the athletes' village has to provide a comfortable environment for them. But at this stage, the standards of the village are not ideal.
Our main concern and the same concern as the head of delegation. So now they are visiting the village, and I know that they have some concern about the apartments, to be sure they will have enough furniture in the apartment, that there will be enough air conditioning in it. And when they have been visiting some venues, they were quite surprised also about the fact that some of the venues were still not refurbished.
There's still work to be done at several venues. The Gwangju University Gymnasium will host the preliminary rounds in basketball, but the refurbishment is not yet finished, and the volleyball venues still need some flooring.
Gwangju University Gymnasium, Donggang College, Naju Multipurpose Gym, and Yangwang Sportium, while the training is at the Gwangju High School Gymnasium.
The third new venue is the archery range. It's still under construction. The delays on the project could hamper the all-important detailed preparations in the final weeks. FISU's Universiade Director is Mark Vandenplas.
it is really very important that everything is settled very, very quickly, because the venue management has to take possession of those spaces as soon as possible. And this is really, for them, it's the key of the success.
The opening ceremony of the University Games takes place at the beginning of July. Time is short. For the organizing committee, there's now a sense of urgency. But among the visitors, the talk at least is positive. The head of the British delegation is Andrew Hibbert.
So I'm absolutely confident that we'll go ahead as scheduled on time.
Back in 2002, Gwangju was one of the host cities for the Football World Cup. And in the same Gwangju Stadium, the opening and closing ceremonies will take place, as well as the athletics competitions. The Russians organized the highly successful University Games in Kazan 2 years ago. So what do they think now? Concerning the stadium, I think the organizers of the Universiad are doing their best. Everything's going to be finished. They're working on all those details that they haven't quite finished yet, as we've seen. Here and there, there are some repairs to do, some details to finish off. But I think it'll be a top-level venue. South Korea has great experience in organizing Universiads, and also the Olympic Games in 1988. So I think they'll rise to the challenge, and everything will be fine. So plenty of optimism that Gwangju will be all set by July. Her name is Hong Jong-ho, a handball Olympic champion in 1992 at the Barcelona Games. She also became world champion in 1995, and now she has a special reason to be pleased for her sport.
It's the first time in this Universiad Games, so I'm very happy to our handball can be in this Universiad. And I hope that many people come to the hall and see, watch how handball is fun and dramatic sports.
Hong was there for the handball group draw, which took place during the visit of the international delegates. Handball's a very popular sport in South Korea, especially for women, and the draw was reasonably kind to them. China, Japan, and Ukraine. In this very first handball competition in Universiad history.
So Japan and China, and I don't know much about Ukraine, but those teams are used to play a lot, and so I know their level of the handball. So I think our group competition games will be not very difficult.
In men's handball, Portugal are the world university champions from last year, and they were drawn in Pool B with their biggest rivals, Brazil, in Group C, and ready for revenge.
We in the hand up, and we lost for Portugal, and now in the Universiad, we prepared our team for the champions.
In basketball, at the Kazan Universiad, Russia were the winners. They'll play in Pool B with Portugal. The USA is grouped with Serbia, the Kazan bronze medalists, Brazil, Turkey, Chile, and Switzerland.
And our men's actually going to be a unified university team, the University of Kansas, for the first time. We're experimenting with a different model. So we'll see how that goes.
In men's football, South Korea will face Canada, Italy, and Chinese Taipei in Pool A, while favorites like France, the winners last time, and Brazil were placed in Pool B and C, respectively. The women's Universiad champions, Brazil, are in a pretty tough group with China, Poland, and North Korea.
Our female team is a very good team. We have 3 or 4 players in the national team. It's possible we stay in the dispute for the championship.
In volleyball, the women's champions are Russia. In Group B, they'll face Taipei, Ukraine, and Switzerland. The silver medalists last time were Brazil. They're in Group C with Japan, the USA, and Finland. Russia are the favorites for another title, but there's no complacency in the Russian camp. It's difficult to judge how the teams will perform during the upcoming Universiade based on their previous Universiade performances. In the men's competition, Russia also come as champions and they're fancied to retain their title in Guangzhou. Up on campus, Alexander Smith, the archer from Oxford. As we put the spotlight on one of the world's greatest universities and look at sports in the city of the dreaming spires.
La Fédération internationale du sport universitaire rassemble des millions d'étudiants du monde entier autour des mêmes valeurs. L'excellence du corps et de l'esprit. Des milliers d'étudiants, des centaines d'universités participent aux événements FISU. Le rendez-vous des meilleurs athlètes étudiants. Star aujourd'hui, leader demain.
I hope to sort of perform really well in the ranking round, and then in the head-to-heads, I would like to go through, and I'd preferably like to try and medal. If not, I feel a good goal would be to try and make, say, the top 16.
His name is Alexander Smith. He's a student at Oxford University, one of the most prestigious universities in the world, and Alexander is one of the finest archers in Britain. His aim, to excel at the World University Games in July.
I know it's the second largest sporting event in the world. I know the level is supposed to be very, very high at the Universiade. I think they say second only really to the Olympics, for archery in particular. It's a great honor to represent, and I know that it's a great experience, and it will be my first experience of a sort of actual multi-sport games, as opposed to just an archery event.
Alex began archery at the age of 14 and quickly got involved at the National Training Centre. Then he went up to Oxford University, where he found the means to develop his chosen sport, but not without effort.
I feel it's extremely difficult to be a top athlete in this sort of university. The amount of work we have to put into our academic work is, I would say on average, we're talking sort of 8-9 hours a day comfortably in the library or in lectures or tutorials. And so from that, to actually push that into doing a sport as well, you have to be prepared to really push yourself sometimes. I mean, you have weeks where getting enough sleep is really quite a challenge because the amount of work you have to do, and you will push yourself to win.
Starting his day at 6:30, Alex spends his morning training, 3 or 4 hours of it, then back for a quick lunch, followed by academic work until 9 in the evening. It's a massive workload, but the fact is, the concentration required to do it actually helps with his archery.
The main focus for the technical sport is, when you first start, you spend a lot of time getting your technique right, doing everything the same. But I feel once you get to a certain level, your technique is okay, it's just controlling your mind. And you're trying to get your mental approach to be the same every single time. Because if you're thinking the same thing in your head, you're most likely doing the same thing with your arms and body and such things. So in order to get the shots really into the middle, you have to be really, really precise in how you're thinking. I'd say the main quality is mental control and being able to do the same thing over again and not lose your patience when you, for instance, have a bad shot.
This mental strength will be really useful in Guangzhou, but he'll go to South Korea with very little knowledge of his opponents.
What you do know is their reputation. We know, for instance, South Korea is known as one of the best countries in the world at archery. America, again, very solid. France is one of the best countries. And so you know that if you shoot against someone from one of those countries, you know in order to represent their country, they have to be very good. However, you know, you take every opponent the same and you know you can beat them. So you just have to bring out your best game.
England has a strong tradition in archery, and Alex will carry the responsibility of upholding the reputation of his country and his university.
I feel in Oxford you are always quite responsible for the image of the university. I feel internationally I've definitely noticed before, even when it's not been a Universiade, people always ask you, oh, if you're a student, where do you study? And when you say Oxford, people see that as quite a sort of quite a large thing, and because of that, I think you are representing the university, and it is quite important to represent that in a good light, because we have such a legacy and we have been around for such a long time.
So for Alex Smith, there'll be pressure, as well as hope and a good deal of eager anticipation in what's going to be a major moment in his life.
Personally, it'll be very important for me, as it's probably the biggest competition I've ever been to before. So if I get to shoot in this, it will be a great honour to represent the country and at university level, especially as I'm finishing this year, so it'd be really nice to sort of go out with that. And further than that, I would like to go to the Olympics one day, so I feel it's a great sort of stepping stone towards that.
Alexander Smith, hoping to be bang on target this summer in South Korea. Oxford. The word is synonymous with academic excellence. Created in 1116, it's the oldest university in the English-speaking world. It's actually a collection of 68 different colleges all gathered in the heart of the old city. And it's here that 22,000 students set out to earn their precious degree.
It's an international, I mean, we have 120 different nationalities at Oxford. We've numerous number of presidents, former presidents of the United States and prime ministers of this country and other countries across the world.
More than 30 world leaders have studied at Oxford, as well as countless leading figures in literature and the arts. Oxford is the alma mater of 36 British prime ministers, more than 50 Nobel laureates, all helping the university to carve out its formidable academic reputation. And yet, still, there is a place for sport.
I think clearly Oxford is an academic institution focusing on academic excellence and performance in the academic field, but sport plays an incredibly high level of importance with the individual students who come here, and the history and the famous sportsmen and women that have come through Oxford.
The tennis player John Boland was an Oxford student, the first British Olympic champion, and the first of 158 Oxford medalists, many from abroad. One of them was the only Olympian to win gold at both the Summer and the Winter Games, the American Eddie Egan. And there was Roger Bannister. It was on May the 6th, 1954, that Bannister became the first man to run a mile in under 4 minutes.
I think this was this breaking of this barrier, this four-minute barrier. It was very, very romantic, and it had world publicity, and it was, of course, people were writing about it many years before, saying it was physically impossible. They said it was impossible to break this barrier, and the fact that he achieved it on his home track of his athletics club, of his university where he'd studied, I just think it touched lots of people's imaginations and basically showed that anything could be achieved.
Yet the sport that Oxford is best known for is rowing and the boat race.
I think the most well-known ones are probably the rowing through the boat race, because, I mean, there's over 6 million people watch that live on the Thames every year. But still, Oxford and Cambridge stays very high in people's consciousness about competition between universities.
Oxford against Cambridge, one of the oldest sporting events in the world. Created in 1829, it's been run annually since 1856, except during the First and Second World Wars. In 1877, there was a dead heat. In 1912, both crews sank. But every year, it still captures the imagination. The boat race is part of the nation's cultural fabric. But although it's a well-established tradition, this year there was a tweak, with a women's race run on the same day for the very first time. The university women had been competing since 1927, but always on a different stretch of water and on a different day. But now, in 2015, on that first race on the big London course, Oxford would take the honours. And they did it, watched by more than 200,000 spectators along the banks of the Thames. As far as the men are concerned, well, Cambridge have won 81 times, but Oxford have taken 11 of the last 16 victories. And with this one held in April, the dark blues notched up victory number 79. And of course, an historic double victory, men and women.
What a fantastic year. You know, for us, this is just the most wonderful day to mark this historic occasion. I'm so pleased for Oxford University Women's Boat Club with their double victory. Yeah. I'm so pleased for ISIS, our reserve crew, winning in some style. And for our crew as well to win, you know, in that definitive style. I'm so, you know, I'm just so happy. This is wonderful.
Nothing captures the university's spirit of friendly competition more than the boat race. But the rivalry between the two universities is not confined to rowing by any means.
The high-profile ones, of course, are the boat race on the Thames and the rugby at Twickenham, but we actually have over 180 different varsity matches a year across 50 or so different sports. So it's very wide and it permeates down to all levels of competition and standing.
Oxford provides its students with 87 sports clubs to allow them to complement their academic education with sport at all levels. The university provides the finance, the infrastructure, the administrative staff, and the coaches.
From the students is 2,500 who play university sport, another 6,000 at college level. So it's approaching 10,000 people, I think, in all that take part in membership of the gym, the pool, or sport. So it's 50% maybe of the university population are involved in sport here.
And yet, despite all the passion surrounding it, sport is certainly not a priority at Oxford University, and the students have to be aware of that.
Je pense que la priorité absolue, c'est nos résultats académiques.
The first priority, of course, is our academic results. So if you ever start to be less successful, they'd immediately tell us to ease up on the training. The priority are the results. We're here to study, that's clear. We know that sport is good, but it really is more important to succeed in our studies.
Il faut vraiment qu'on réussisse nos étudiants.
While across the world, sport is becoming more professional, at universities like this, there's growing pressure to produce top-quality academic graduates. It begs the question over the future of high-performance sport at Oxford, despite its impressive history.
It is amazing. I think, I mean, there is the range of sports that we have excelled at the Olympics is quite amazing, and it does go back many years. I think things have changed recently. The onset of professionalism in the last 20, 30 years in many Olympic sports means that things have moved on, and Oxford are not able to necessarily produce the same number of athletes at that elite level. But that's down to the balance of being academically brilliant and sportingly brilliant, and I think increasingly in the modern time, it's incredibly hard to replicate both aspects of somebody's life.
John Roycroft, the Oxford University Director of Sport, on the achievements and the challenges ahead. Still to come on the programme, the big annual Sport Accord Convention in Sochi, where sport comes together with business. And the inspiration of Romania's Minister for Sport, the great Gabriela Szabo.
Education meets sport and culture. What best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet?
La Fédération internationale du sport universitaire rassemble des millions d'étudiants du monde entier autour des mêmes valeurs, l'excellence du corps et de l'esprit. Des milliers d'étudiants, des centaines d'universités participent aux événements FISU. Le rendez-vous des meilleurs athlètes étudiants. Star aujourd'hui, leader demain.
Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.
The annual Sport Accord Convention, the summit of world sport and business, has been taking place at Sochi in Russia. The convention brings together more than 100 international federations and affiliated organizations. For FISU, a founding member, it's the opportunity to meet many of its partner federations.
One of the reasons we're here is to reinforce the relationship with the international federations. Without them, we're nowhere. We have to arrange calendars, unite people. We need judges, technicians. We do multi-sport.
on fait du multisport.
The convention was the occasion for signing agreements with federations like the IAAF, the International Athletics Federation, and canoeing. And FISA also took the opportunity of promoting the university sport movement and future universiades.
We are here with our two next organizing committees, Almaty and Taipei. It was important to show to the world, because all the world of sports is here in Sochi, that we have a good organizing committee and good games that will come in Kazakhstan, Almaty, and of course in Taipei, Chinese Taipei. And for Taipei, it's important because it will be the first major sports event, multi-sports event in the country. And that's why it's important for them. It will be the best way for them to promote the city of Taipei, but also the whole country.
In 2017, while Chinese Taipei will organize the Summer Universiade, Almaty will host the Winter University Games. Almaty is Kazakhstan's main commercial and cultural hub, a city with nearly 1.5 million people, and it's intended that the Universiade will have a beneficial effect on its citizens.
We're absolutely sure that Winter Universiade and Winter Students Games will bring a huge impulse for the developing youth sport, student sport, and to make all our nation more healthy.
2 years later, in 2019, another Russian city will organize a Universiade, following the success of Kazan in 2013. Located in the northeast, the Siberian city of Krasnoyarsk promises what it calls real winter, a unique occasion for students and athletes.
I believe Universiade is a unique chance to give this opportunity to see I am a member of a great team, I am responsible for my university, for my country, for my city. I think it's one of the main tasks for education.
41% of the population of Krasnoyarsk is younger than 30, among them more than 100,000 students. It's a city with a reputation for sport, and its big showcase takes place in 4 years' time. For the University Games of 2021, two cities have already said they'd like to take on the role. As the Secretary General of the International Federation of University Sports confirmed at the Sport Accord Convention.
We have already a good potential candidate, one in Europe. I can say that we have close contact now with Bucharest in Romania. Another one in Switzerland for the winter. We already mentioned Luzern for the Winter Games. I can just mention them because it has been in the media already.
The Romanian initiative is supported by sports legends like Gabriela Szabo and the gymnast Nadia Comăneci. The 11th Summer Universiade was held in Romania back in 1981, and the Olympic champion started those games winning 5 gold medals.
So now that a big enthusiasm of Bucharest, Romania also being candidating for bringing back the University Games to Bucharest.
While the Romanians say they are preparing a bid for 2021, the Romanian government still has to give its approval. But as far as FISA is concerned, an event on this scale would certainly be beneficial for Romania, both economically and socially. Romania's Gabriela Szabo symbolizes the FISU slogan, today's stars, tomorrow's leaders. Gabriela is one of the student athletes who's reached not only the pinnacle of their sport, but beyond. Gabriela is a former Universiade champion, and last year she was appointed as Romania's Minister of Youth and Sport. I have to admit that having been nominated as a minister was a surprise for me. Once I finished my career as an athlete in 2004, I realized I was tired and that my body and spirit were not able to carry on as a high-performance athlete. It was a surprise for everybody because it was a sudden decision, so nobody was really expecting it. I didn't feel like competing in another Olympic Games. I'd rather prefer that people have a good memory of me, like Gabi Szabo on the podium. Before becoming Olympic champion in the 5,000 meters in Sydney, she was a star on the Universiade track, winning double gold at Fukuoka in 1995 in the 1500 and the 5,000. And she took gold in the 1500 at the World University Games in Sicily in 1997. All this while she was still busy with her academic studies in physical and sports education. I never neglected my education, and my teachers were really understanding. I realized that education was really very important, just as important as high performance sport. The triple world champion and winner of 4 world indoor titles is still very close to the students and to the Romanian people. She's a role model in Romanian society. My message is, everything we have to do, we have to do it with passion. We have to find the necessary motivation to move forward without ever giving up. Everything we do, we have to be passionate about and devote ourselves to it. That is how I accomplish things in life. I always did it with all my heart and a lot of passion. Otherwise, things won't work. It's important to dream of being the best at a certain point in your life. Being the best meant not only celebrating victories, it meant facing challenges and dealing with them. And that's the attitude she still has today as Romania's Minister for Youth and Sport. Gabriela Szabo, the one-time inspirational university icon who became an athletic superstar and then a leader in society. And that was Campus Sport.
Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders,